Hello, I'm Paul Rasidi, a developer programs engineer on the Google Cloud platform. I'm extremely passionate about Compute Engine and mobile apps, so not too long ago, I started work on some applications that use both. I realized there are probably other developers out there wanting to do something similar, so I recently open sourced a sample app. I'm going to show a demo of the app and then briefly talk about the process of building it in Android Studio. The README file included with the sample app on GitHub explains how to deploy the app for yourself, so you can get it running on your own Android device. First, the demo. The application is a simple one that utilizes the CE API Java Client Library to retrieve project resource information. It pulls information about all active resources from a developer project you've previously registered. As you can see, we start with the login page where you can choose a Google account. We're going to select my sample account. This account listing is pulled from the Google accounts registered on the Android device, to avoid requiring the user to re-enter their password. Now that we've done that, the code asks Android for an OAuth2 token for that account, with OAuth2 scopes for Compute Engine and Cloud Storage. I will accept this prompt, and now the application is able to retrieve OAuth2 access tokens. As a reminder, an OAuth2 access token is a time-limited authorization string that provides access to Compute Engine and Cloud Storage APIs on behalf of a user. Next, we type in a project ID for the developer project that the Google account has access to. This obviously needs to be a project that is already using CE, or at least has the API enabled. This value can either be the project name string or the project number, which we received from the console. We'll now click this View Resources button, and a new activity is invoked. The app talks with the CE API in the background and loads the resource information. We can see that we have a few instances and disks, as well as the zones that our project has access to. We can also see that this instance has a scheduled outage coming up. This is actually an instance I meant to delete earlier, so we'll drill into this and delete it. Again, the app performs the delete asynchronously with the CE API. Pretty simple app. For this app, we decided to use the Android Master Detail sample. So if you run the app on a tablet, you'll notice it nicely combines the first and second activities together. This is Android Fragments at work, but more about this later. Now let's look at the code. In order to look at the code, we're going to need to retrieve it. That's easy enough. We're going to check out the source code using Git and then import the project via the import option in Android Studio. We'll select the highest level project, use the gradle wrapper option, and import. If you're having trouble here, please see the README in the code repo for more comprehensive instructions. Now that we have the code, the easiest way for us to understand this project is to look at the code as it was committed. You can see the first few commits are Project Wizard generated code, and I'm manually defining entries in gitignore. The structure is a bit different from the Eclipse environment. As you can see, we're excluding the build directory, as well as the idea and gradle hidden directories. All of these files should be inferred from the main build gradle file, so there's no need to check them in. We're also excluding the lib directory, since we're pulling in our dependencies via Maven vis-a-vis gradle. More on gradle a little later. For the Project Wizard commit, I used all the defaults except that I chose a minimum SDK of 11 so that I had Android Fragments available. This allowed me to use the Master Detail sample as the basis of my app. You don't have to choose version 11 if you're creating your own app and don't want Fragments, but I like the simplicity of the tablet interface we saw earlier. The next commit is a doozy. It contains the addition of the API interaction code to the project. All of our code that uses the CE API is here, since we need to keep network calls off the user interface thread. You can see we basically instantiate an API stub. Create a command, then execute the command. In the case of a delete command, we're going to make an additional status call and wait for it to complete. In this commit, I also snuck in the addition of a login activity. It's the sample login activity that can be created with a right-click in Android Studio, like this. Finally, you will notice a critical change in the build.gradle file in this commit. If you aren't familiar with Gradle, then you can probably get away with the fact that it is the new preferred way to define your builds. This snippet is specifically pulling in all of our dependencies by defining them as Maven dependencies. All of the Google Client Library for Android jars, as well as the Surface extension for Compute, will be added to the project because of these lines. The snippet does use Maven, but you are still required to have downloaded some libraries via the SDK manager. Read through the comments in the snippets for the specific packages you need to have fully updated. The next commit has us implementing the login activity to use the Google account credential. This is an Android-aware credential that will reuse Google accounts on the device and allow applications OAuth2 token access. Finally, the last interesting commit is the implementation of the resources list to connect to the async tasks we checked in earlier. In this commit, we adjusted the XML layout files to display our resources and updated the list and detail fragments to display our instances, disks, and zones. That's about it for the code. I'm really looking forward to seeing some applications on mobile devices that use the Compute Engine API. I appreciate your time and would ask that you star our project on GitHub and/or the video to indicate they were useful. Thank you.